Hi there. So we're now going to take a look at some work samples, some things that students in New South Wales public schools have actually been able to design in 3D using the STEM.T4L 3D printing kit. These are a range of different learning challenges that have been done throughout different stages in New South Wales schools, and we're going to take a bit of a look at some of the things that students have actually been able to achieve in a very short space of time.
Yeah, let's dive in, Brett.
So what we can see here is actually kind of where it all began. This is a learning challenge and it relates to the learning challenge that you'll find on the STEM.T4L learning library that is called the Toy Story Challenge. And we'll put a link up on screen for that so that you can access that very, very easily. Now, this learning challenge actually came out of, the students in stage one were learning about the history of toys. And they were learning about the history of toy design, and they were learning about the history of the Lego company and wooden toys and toys that
were... So things they're really familiar with.
Yeah, and the concept that, well, the history, that toys were not always a thing for students or a thing for children. There was a period of time when commercially available toys didn't even exist. So it's really interesting for students to actually engage in that conversation and be able to just understand that commercially available toys haven't actually always been a thing.
You're going to start talking about the design process straight away because the toys have evolved from, you know, many, many years ago into what we can sort of see on the screen here. Tell us about these work samples, Brett.
So what we can see here is the first designs that were ever done by students that I had the privilege of teaching. Now, these were The question was posed to the students, design a toy that does not already exist. Now, designing something that doesn't already exist is very, very hard when you don't have a baseline. So what we can see here is the students actually came up with the concept of combining things that do already exist. So here we can see the design is a Formula One racing car that is steam powered and also has wings. Now you
lots
can,
of fun.
Yeah, and you can't buy that toy. That toy does not already exist.
Yep.
Now I'm sure that we've all taken some kids into a toy shop, into a Kmart, a Big W, anywhere that's got a toy section. And if there's a birthday coming up, I'm sure we've all had this experience where you go in and you say, right, I want you to choose something for the birthday coming up, for your cousin or a friend or whoever it is. And usually what happens is the student or the child who you're there with will say, ah, there's nothing here. There's nothing here. And I believe that that is because primarily those toys are designed by adults.
So we want toys designed by children.
For children.
For children.
That's right.
Definitely.
So what we can see here is we're now looking at things that are designed by children in the way that they find it interesting. So these designs came out of that process. On the screen here, you can now see a design that was put together by a year two student. And this was designed to be a cat car with a princess castle at the back and a massive cannon. Now, the big cannon at the top was put there because I will never forget the conversation. Little girl in year two, she told me that she didn't like all of the, girls' toys, and that was her words. I said, well, why not? And she said, well, none of the girls' toys have ever got any cool weapons. They've never got, they're never race cars. They're always princesses and ponies and fairies, and I don't like that stuff. And I said, well, let's design something that you do like. Let's put that together. So that's what she put together for us.
She's identified the need. There was a gap in the market and she's designed for
exactly,
that gap.
Yeah, perfect. And that's exactly what she wanted. And some of these rudimentary designs, they then become exactly what that student wants. Now, the kind of thing that we can come up with, often we see in primary schools, students studying things like space. We see students studying government. We see them taking that, trip to Canberra.
Yes.
The rite of passage.
All year six classes.
Now, these things that you can see on the screen, they were designed in 3D software, but they were not designed for the purpose of 3D printing. Quite often, the 3D design process is not about 3D printing. Quite often, it is about design. It is about actually coming up with a 3D design for the purpose of possibly putting on a poster or designing something else.
Going through that prototyping process.
That's right, because having one or two or even a handful of 3D printers in your school, if you've got the opportunity to have more than one, that's great, but you can't always print everything. So the 3D design process is about so much more than just 3D printing. So some of these designs were for the purpose of 3D printing and some of them weren't. The next design that I'm showing here, this was actually designed using Photoshop as a design tool. And the reason why it was designed in that way was because this student actually made Toothless from How to Train Your Dragon, and it was made as a sculpture out of paper clips wrapped in wool, wrapped in masking tape. And it was a really excellent design, but it wasn't going to last long.
Mm-hmm.
So we photographed that sculpture from all of its sides, dropped it into, in this instance, Photoshop, but it was then traced over to allow the student to make more organic shapes, make those irregular type of objects and drop those into a 3D design in that way.
And I could imagine get more detail than what they were able to achieve with their real life model as well.
That's right, and also make things in a way that allows those very irregular shapes to come together in a way that is probably a little more simple than piecing it together out of primitive objects. Now, authentic problems, a little bit of further knowledge, a little bit of background knowledge can come into this. Remember the fidget spinner phase? I'm sure.
How do we all forget?
I think every teacher can remember the fidget spinner phase. Now, the idea of allowing the students to make their own, design something that was symmetrical or mm-hmm. possibly even asymmetric. But the reason why this project becomes so important is because of the measurement that was involved. Those bearings are a very particular size. Now, allowing the students to use a tool, maybe even like vernier calipers, that will measure to 2 decimal places of a millimeter, if the bearing doesn't fit in the hole perfectly,
it's not going to work.
It's not going to work. It will either fall through the hole or it won't fit.
Mm-hmm.
And allowing your students to design things like small catapults that have something like a fulcrum. Now, that small catapult that we can see in the design here, that has a toothpick as the axle. Through the fulcrum, there is a toothpick as the axle. Now, the reason why it's a toothpick is for two very simple reasons. First reason is toothpicks are quite cheap. And the second reason is that it's a very particular size. And it turns out that the hole that went through the middle of the axle there needed to be around 1.6 millimeters. If we made the hole 1 millimeter, it was too small. Mm-hmm. If we made the hole 2 millimeters, it was too big. Now, for a stage 3 student, learning about a decimal place of a millimeter, that's really important. The difference between 1 millimeter and 2 is a big difference. It's twice the size.
The way you were talking about fulcrum, you could bring in physics and everything into
Absolutely.
Your design as well.
So making 3D designs that have moving parts and allowing your students to build complexity into an industrial design that is something like a toy, something that they can relate to, are the kinds of things that you can do with a 3D printer. Mm. Now, as we move to the next design. This is a story where at the school that I was working at, we used to have live chicken eggs and the eggs would hatch into chicks. Now, one of the chicks came out of the egg and it was quite badly deformed. It had a leg at a very unusual angle. So one of our office staff who had a chicken coop actually took the chick home, and in about 3 weeks, chickens grow pretty fast. She then brought the chicken back in, and the students went about the process of actually designing and prototyping a prosthetic limb for the disabled chicken.
I love that. What a great authentic purpose for this chicken.
And the thing is that the amount of measurement, design, reiterations, and prototyping that came into that was a moment for those students, and it was a cross-stage composite class. It was a 4-5 composite. And those students the amount of understanding around designing for a particular need, measurement, articulation, communication.
Stability.
Yeah, yep. But the articulation, communication, justification for their design becomes part of the learning experience in yep. itself. And the thing is, you cannot plan for something like this. These are the kinds of things that will present themselves to you when you have a 3D printer available. These kinds of things can come up. Challenges like this will present themselves to you. And when you get your 3D printing brain on and you start saying, hey, I've noticed that I could probably solve that problem with a specific design. So
look at all these different variations.
Yeah, so these kinds of prototypes, design iterations, all of them are correct and yet none of them are correct. It's coming up with a design that might be the solution to the problem and then going through the testing process.
Yeah, every option is completely different. So every student's approached the same issue in a very different way.
Yeah, so the concept of coming up with this, allowing all of our students to do the same thing is more of a procedure, whereas we're talking more design thinking. We're talking more of
very open-ended.
That's right. Now, designing things like rockets, designing prototypes, allowing our students to come up with things that can be for multiple different reasons, designing satellites, all of these kinds of designs are really important. But then we come to things like architectural design and allowing our students to come up with things like design your ultimate classroom. Now, the school that I was working at had that process of going through, let's redesign the learning environment.
Which is happening in a lot of schools at
Absolutely.
The moment.
Absolutely. Yep. And I posed the question to the students, what would your ultimate classroom look like?
Yep.
Now, this particular work sample was designed in Google SketchUp. And this particular work sample, I'm going to let it orbit around just slightly and then pause it. The reason why I'm showing this is because there is a fundamental flaw in that design. Now, if you're wondering what the design is, it is a red carpet leading up to a stage with a jacuzzi on the inside and a swimming pool on the roof. The ultimate classroom.
Definitely.
Now, the reason why I show this is because it has a problem. The roof and the back wall are two-dimensional. And there is no such thing as a two-dimensional object in real life. Everything is 3D.
It's flat like a piece of paper in this design.
Well, a piece of paper has a thickness. It's still a three-dimensional object. It is still a prism. This is 2D, and your computer can show you a representation of what 2D looks like, although there isn't actually anything that is two-dimensional. So what we end up with when we try to print something like this that has two-dimensional objects mm-hmm. in it is a fail.
Oh dear.
It's what I refer to as a first attempt in learning, a fail. Now, the computer can show you what two-dimensional looks like, and the 3D printer tries to interpret what the three-dimensional attributions of that might be, but it can't achieve it.
There's just nothing to support that top layer.
That's right, it has no structural integrity.
Yeah.
So we end up with a basket of string. You will get 3D prints that fail. Sometimes we do fail, but often we learn more from the failure than we do from the success.
Definitely.
The students in that class were able to see the integrity of a three-dimensional object and what a two-dimensional object in theory is compared to what things are in real life. Now, this can then move on to all kinds of other design features that can happen with things like architectural design. Quite often we see in the, I suppose, marketplace or in industry where buildings are obviously designed in the computer first. Furniture is designed in the computer first. Even things like new tech ads. When you see an ad for a new watch or a new computer, those are not photographs, those are all 3D designs. So allowing your students to engage with the fundamentals of three-dimensional design then moves on to allowing your students to build in architecture, industrial design, 3D gaming, all of those kinds of learning experiences come out of this type of early learning experience. So I think one of the big messages to take away from this is that 3D printing isn't always about 3D printing. It's more about design. It's about the fundamentals of allowing your students to build with three-dimensional objects, measurement, articulation, communication, collaboration, all of those things come into it. And often the things that your students are designing and the learning that they're really getting out of it isn't really about a 3D print. It's about what would the solution be in 3D to the identified problem.
Yeah, I love the way you've explained the story behind each of these work samples, because straight away I can actually place where it would sit in the curriculum. So the links to the maths curriculum, the design thinking as part of the science and technology syllabus. The students are getting to go through all those steps and refine and come up with a prototype or potentially a finished working model at the end.
That's right. So we hope that this has really sparked some ideas, and we can see that, well, what can you make with a 3D printer? Well, anything you like made of plastic. And that's a pretty hard answer, because anything you like.
Thanks.
This video is part of a series of support videos all about the kit that you have borrowed. To find the other videos in this series, head to the Learning Library and visit the kit page for the equipment you've borrowed. You can also find the full list of support videos for all of our kit on the YouTube channel. You can also join us in the Yammer community. If you have any questions or you'd like to ask teachers how they've used the equipment in their classroom, then why not join us on the STEM T4L Facebook community? It's a closed group. You can ask teachers how they've used the equipment and also share the work samples that your students have created.